Thank you. Thank you, Carla. And thank you to Stonington Free Library for the invitation. Can you hear me okay? Good. A little bit louder? Okay. It's really, yeah, there's a question. How's that?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. I might be going up and down and up and down. But thank you. Yes, I think I'll talk without the mask. It's a pleasure to be here. And in this short time, we'll be covering a little bit about the history of the harp. We're going to be covering the fundamentals and the components of what a harp is made out of or made from, as well as some famous harpists, and last but not least, some harp techniques. But before I start talking a lot, I thought that I would just warm up with a song because I think you'd rather hear me play the harp than talk a lot. So let me start out with The Fields of Gold by Sting. Of the harp. It was developed over 3,500 BC. So the Egyptians are taking credit for the start of harp making. It was essentially a hunter's bow, and it had filaments of animal gut, maybe about 3 strings, 4 strings at the most, because it wasn't very stiff. And the harp developed in Egypt through 3 dynasties, but in addition to Egypt, it also was being discovered in Mesopotamia, in Africa, and in the Far East. So this was a time of instrument kind of discovery. The harp, we're going to move faster in history, and how would the harp have gotten to Ireland? Well, there's a lot of trading that went on, and I kept looking up all the reasons why Ireland would be, you know, thought of as the harp capital. But the Phoenicians had brought the harps because it was an international, as they called it, an international trading good. and they traded it with tin. And so Ireland had tin, and so it proceeded to develop up there. The harps became more sturdy. They had columns. They had more strings to them, obviously. And there were quite a number of harpists that would go from town to town and play songs of love, songs of love's lost, songs of battle songs and mythological songs. And harp players would play right in the grass. They believed that it was close to nature, and they would be sitting right down on the ground. The British weren't really thrilled with the Irish wanting to have these harps. And so in the 1600s, the British decreed that all harps be burned and all harpists executed. And so, yeah. So it wasn't Ireland didn't really take it too seriously until the British really meant what they were saying. And so for 100 years, then harps weren't played, and harp music wasn't in Ireland. But they persevered and went. I'd like to play two of the Celtic songs. One is the Galway Boy, and the next one is The River Is Wide. And I had a hard time segueing the different genres of harp music. So I'd also like to play two Beatles songs because they're from the British Isles. So I really tried to fit those in somehow, and that's where I decided they would land. Okay, this first one is the Galway Boy, and I give credit to Rory Cotton, who I used to play with, and she did all these flourishes for this song. So unfortunately, she couldn't be here today, but she'll be listening, I'm sure. Next one is called The Water Is Wide, and you might have recognized it. It's been in a variety of movie themes. This is from the traditional British Isles. George Harrison's Here Comes the Sun. We need that today. Gotta Hide Your Love Away by Lennon McCartney. Mm-hmm. Okay, back to my cards. Where were we? We were in the 1600s in Ireland. And as we get into the 1700s, the harp became more an item for aristocracy. Aristocrats really liked these, especially those in Central Europe. And one famous harpist was Marie Antoinette. And this was the picture that's been advertised for the harp engagement. And she started playing the harp at age 11. She was the 15th child of the Empress and Emperor of Austria. And so at age 15, she was promised to be the Queen of France, and she was to be married to King Louis the 16th. So when she was learning the harp, she became good friends and better than an acquaintance with Mozart. So she learned to play the harp very quickly. And when she moved to France, she was able to play for all of her extravagant parties in the Chateau of Versailles. So she was also great at spending money. So she did a lot of horse racing in the chateau. She did extravagant parties, and she just lived the life of luxury. And so the French Revolution came, and the French people really didn't think kindly to her extravagance. And the king first got executed, and then Marie Antoinette. But her harp was as gold and as ornate as you could possibly think. It just had a kind of a big scroll, kind of like a big shell at the top. And she really did it up. So not to say that she was a good harpist, and we're going to soon talk about the components of the harp. Okay, where am I? Harps kind of then evolutionized for concerts in the 1800s. And the first thing that happened was a single action type of harp, where you are just playing it and you can't change keys unless you use some sort of hand lever up here. So a man named Mr. Erad, in I think the early, well, almost at 1800, in 1796, he invented a system with discs where when the discs are turned using pedals, I'm going to explain this in just a second, you're now going to be able to bring the note up a half a step or the note down a half a step. I'm going to turn the harp around. Sorry, I'm probably messing the microphone up a little bit. But two men, Patrick Healy and George Lyon, in early 1900s, they decided to go into business manufacturing harps. Up to that point, harps were just individualized, and you could order a harp, but it would take you a long time. So this is a Lyon and Healy harp. It's a semi-grand, and it is a double-action harp. So all harps that are used in orchestras have these pedals down at the bottom, and there is a pedal for each note of the scale. So we have a pedal, and there's one pedal for the C's, and then there's one pedal for the D's, and then there's a pedal for the E's, and then a pedal for the F's, and on. So So a harpist has to know exactly where her feet are. It's more important to know where the feet are than the fingers sometimes. So how do these things work? What happens is this pedal has a coupling at the end of it that's attached to a long stainless steel rod that goes through the column. So there's seven rods in the column of the harp. Then it goes all the way to the top, and there are mechanisms that are underneath this big gold plate that are brass, and they look like mini socket wrenches that are attached to each other. So there's a coupling up here. So there's over 1,500 moving parts in a harp, seven pedals and 47 strings. That's enough to keep track of. But when you push down, the rod gets tight and the mechanisms go down and they twist these discs. And if you can see, the little pins are now moving. So, and that happens for all the strings. There we go. So you can see the pins moving on the top and the bottom as well. So if you have a piece that is not going to change key and it's just you just have F sharps, you just set that pedal for F sharp and you don't have to worry about anything for the rest of the piece. But if it does change key, then you have to know way ahead of time what you're going to have to do to lift all the pedals at a certain time without it buzzing. These are so precise that if it's off by maybe a little millimeter, you're going to have buzzing down here and up above. So the strings are made out of a sheep gut, and a harpist always has to have an extra set of strings in her car because you never know when something's going to break. And she's responsible for stringing the harp. And sometimes the string may fall off its pin or come off of the disc, and then you can kind of snap that back on. But if you have a problem where the rod is broken, then you'll probably need to either take it to a harp repair guy, and the only one is about a mile away from Logan Airport, or back to Chicago. So, as I said, this one is a semi-concert brand. Lyon and Healy first came out in 1936 with the Salzedo model, and it's a beautiful Art Deco type of harp. It's very streamlined, and it's the top of the line. And it was named after Mr. Salzedo, and we'll talk about him in just a little bit. Then in 1964, for their 100th anniversary of Lyon and Healy, they made the Centennial model, or the model 100, and this is what the model 100 is. And I had used or had bought, my parents bought, the style 100 about 40 years ago, and I thought that was going to do me out, but harps do wear out and they come unglued, and the sounding board comes up, and the only thing to do is have it taken apart and a new sounding board put back on, and that would have taken about 9 months. So instead, they happen to have a refurbished one when I needed one. So how lucky was that? That was great. So the company in Chicago is just an amazing manufacturing company. It looks the same since I was little. It is on the corner of Ogden and Wabash, and it's kind of like this wonderful Willy Wonka type of thing. You go in and you've got a reception area, and they do tours. They don't do tours during COVID, but the first floor is receiving, and then you go into the elevator and you get up, and it's just a floor of sounding boards. And they hand select pieces of wood from the Pacific Northwest and from Upper Minnesota, and the wood is a Sitka spruce. So it has to be just a certain high grade of wood, and it has to dry for at least a year and a half. So they're hanging these wonderful sounding boards on hooks, kind of like meat hooks, in this floor of the factory. And then you get back in the elevator and you go up a second floor, and everybody's hard at work. There's just dozens of employees that are just working on the mechanisms underneath. They're these brass kind of snakes, and they're tapping them and making sure that they're accurate and to specification. Then you go up to the next floor, and you have them constructing the harp and also adding whatever finish you want, whether it's mahogany or whether it's gold leaf. You can get them in just, you know, amazingly delicate and intricate designs. Then the second to the last floor is the showroom, where there's dozens and dozens of harps that you can try out. It's kind of like kid in a candy store. And they said, take your time, you know. I was like, okay, I will. And then the top floor is the concert hall. So it's all in one. It survived the Great Chicago Fire of 1871. The whole thing burned to the ground, but Lyne and Healy decided they're just going to keep going, and they're going strong. They did come into some financial times in 2003, where Alberto Salvi, and he is a famous harpist, if you ever hear of his name, he's also an Italian harp maker, and he decided to keep the company afloat, but still keeping the Lyne and Healy name. And they tout themselves as the world's finest harps. So principal harpists and first chair harpists from the Sydney Orchestra or from Hong Kong or from, you know, San Francisco will come and just stay in the showroom until they pick out a harp of their choice. So it's a really fun place to go if you're ever in Chicago. Okay, so we're moving on. How am I doing? I'm doing good. Okay. I'm going to pull the harp back. And we're going to talk about famous harpists. So, another famous harpist, it happens to be Marcel Grandjean, and he was born in 1891 in Paris, and he studied at the age of 9 at the Paris Conservatory. He was a virtuoso harpist, but at 8 in his 20s, he decided to move to New York City, and he became in charge of the harp department at Juilliard. So at such an early age, and he was invited to play in these amazing orchestras, the Philadelphia Harmonic, the Cleveland Orchestra, the Chicago, all the named ones. He also was in charge of the conservatory up in Montreal. So each month for dozens and dozens of years, he would travel from Juilliard up to Montreal and take care of things up there, and then come right back. So he was busy. He was very understated. I'm trying to think of a word. And his technique was what Mr. Drusinski, these are the hands of my teacher. He has since passed away. He was in the Chicago Symphony. And if you notice, his fingers are flexible. They kind of go like this. And he just gave me liberty to get to whatever strings I needed to with how I could manage. And that was the beauty of Mr. Grandjean's methods. It was understated, And I'm going to read you a part from that. As a teacher, Grangeny's influence is hard to overstate. His method, like Salzado's, is taught all over the world, resulting in an us versus them. So there still continues to be a lot of competition. A rivalry in the arena of harp pedagogy. Grangeny was known as a sensuous harpist. His technique was by his large spatula-shaped fingertips, if you can imagine what that looks like. So, but he was able to get through all these hard parts of orchestra or orchestra parts with ease and just with grace. So on that note, I'd like to play you a composition that Mr. Grangeny had written, and then we'll go on to Mr. Salzado and compare them. So, this is the Bon Rat, Petit Rat de Vieux Eventow. Now we're going to compare Mr. Salzado. Well, the first teacher that I had was Grangeny, and then the second teacher I had was Salzado method. So yeah, I went from Grangeny to Salzado to Grangeny. So I don't know what technique I have anymore, but it seems to work. Mr. Salzado was born in the same approximate time as Grangeny. He grew up, he was raised and born in France, and he went to the Paris Conservatory, like Grangeny did, just a few years later. And he was a brilliant pianist, too, as well, as a child. So he, like Grangeny, moved to New York, and he became the principal harp for the Metropolitan Opera. And he was invited to play for all of these orchestras as well. So he was brilliant, and a lot of adjectives for him. He was brilliant. He was caustic. He was superior. He was disagreeable. He was a lot of things. And I would call him very complicated. The teachers that I've had were direct students of Mr. Salzado. So it's amazing to note that two men continue to be the leaders of harp technique when there are no women leaders, but it's a female industry with just a few exceptions. He served in the French army in World War I, but then he came, he was definitely going to be a serious teacher, and he developed a method of using gestures in harp method, and it was inspired by the Russian dancer Nijinsky. I guess they became friends. And he performed as soloist for many organizations. He married, I guess, a wonderful gal, Mamine Graham, in 1914. But I guess it was understood that with Mamine that he would be courting his latest star pupil. So he was going out on the town with the latest prima harpist. And finally, she just called it quits. So how did he establish the Maine Salzado harp colony in Camden, Maine? And he started this by getting an idea from when he spent a summer or two up in Seal Harbor, Maine, playing for dinner parties for the Rockefellers and the Vanderbilts, and so he had quite a following. So he thought, oh gosh, I've got something. And so he bought this beautiful estate, I would call it, which overlooks Camden Harbor. And when I was there for 3 summers, when I had first started, I had no clue how hard this was going to be. I thought, oh great. But I'm realizing that there must have been a lot of strings that were pulled by my harp teacher in order to get me into this colony. So you would be practicing 8 to 10 hours a day, and you would be renting a room in one of the houses that would accept harpist and board. And then you would be taking 2 lessons, maybe it was a Monday and a Thursday or a Tuesday and a Friday. And you would walk all the way around the harbor and wait for your lesson to begin and let the harpist that was taking her lesson to finish. And it was quite an experience. It wasn't anything relaxing. So Salzado's technique was pretty much the opposite. You had to have your thumbs were straight up. You had to have all your hands or your fingers placed into your palm when they were done playing that note. You had to have your wrists bent and your elbows up. So there was no slouching either. And this was the natural pose when you started out. And it took me a while to kind of get the feel of this. And also, the teachers would make me practice. See, I would have to hear my hand going into the palm of my hand. And when, as a little kid, I could barely, grab an octave on the harp. So he was also instrumental in different sound effects of the harp. And I'm going to chop up this next piece in 3 parts, just because the pedals would be knocking, and I can kind of describe what's going on piece by piece. So it's a very short piece. What am I doing? I'm too good. Okay. All right. This one is called Chanson dans la nuit. Since those guys were French, they did name their pieces this way. Okay. Again, this is Salzado, and he just did a lot of composition. So. Okay. that's the first part. So then he's in that part, he's demonstrating two notes can sound the same. So that's why it sounds very fairy-like. This next one gets into his demonstration of how to use the backside of your nails and when you're playing, and also using the sounding board to sound like woodpeckers, I think. So here's this next part. Reminds me of flying monkeys in The Wizard of Oz. So this was his next sound effect, and so let's see if I got them all set. Yes. It needed, all of that needed explanation. So I'm glad you hung in there with me. Okay. Well, now the fun stuff. So now you've got kind of an education. I'm going to play a few songs so that you kind of know that the harp is very versatile. And then I'd be happy to answer questions. So let me do one from Henry Mancini, Moon River, and then I'm going to do a John Mayer song, and then if I have time, I'm going to be doing something from Bonnie Raitt. Thank you. Daughters. Oh, since I have two of them. That might be a good explanation. I think it was small because transportation was hard. And so they would get a belt strap and they would strap it to their back and they would go, you know, over the hill, over dale with it on their back. The Welsh, yes, were you know, they had strong music ties and harp background as well as the Scots too. You know, all the British Isles. Yes. That's a great question. Okay. This harp. Now this is a used one. Oh. Something fell out. Yes. Sorry. Yeah. I'm almost done. For a brand new harp, which is the Centennial model, and I'm lucky I have two harps, one I can keep at work and one I can take on the road and practice. And the newer harp, at least 7 years ago, was $25,000. So this one, you're able to trade in the harp. They'll give you kind of a bounty for your old harp. And this one was about 13,000, I think. Yeah. So yes. I do. I recorded it soundless twice, and I'd be happy to give you a copy, Noreen. It's just a sampler of some of the things that I've done. So I'll drop that off for
And how much does that weigh?
you. This weighs 70, well, not 78. With the cover on, it weighs 108.
And then, so how do you get it around?
You have to have a strong back.
Yeah.
And
Is it twisted?
you can actually, and I'm probably going to knock things over and go crazy with it, but if you balance it out, you can kind of lift it up from this way. So yeah, strong back and strong
A lot of harp.
what?
And a lot of
At
harp.
a station wagon. Some people prefer, some harpists prefer a minivan. I wasn't a minivan type of gal, so station wagon.
Have you played a harp similar to me on some of the 18th century harps?
The very
Surely it didn't have all of those clips
and
and
turns and
things.
stuff. The harp that Marie Antoinette played is in, not in the Louvre, but it's in one of the Musées de
Yeah,
Versailles.
it's in the Trianon or Fontainebleau.
Yeah,
I've
yeah,
heard it.
yeah.
But yours is
It's
more standard,
yeah,
right?
it's very ornate and
This one, I noticed right at the beginning, you had a lot of petals.
right.
It was gorgeous. I mean, I'm floating on clouds.
And you aren't supposed to know the petals. I'm not supposed to be, fiddling around with them and making lots of knocking sounds, but.
The one that Mozart would have composed for would have been a little less.
Yes, he didn't go there with a lot of key signatures. He did the sonata in C major, flute and harp concerto. So that was really easy. So, yeah.
There's some similarity to a harpsichord also,
It
of a plane or a thing or a
is.
what.
The harp is
Yeah.
very similar to the shape of a concert grand piano. So if you laid the harp down on its side, you would be getting the exact same thing underneath the hood.
So is there a string with middle C?
Yes, it's the red one.
The bright red one,
Yeah.
what do the fingers have to do behind the sounding board?
Oh, that's a great question. There's a special knot, and it's kind of like doing a fishing lure. So you have to like do two loops and then connect them, and you have to thread the string through, get the loop very tight, and put an anchor, like a piece of the old of a big string, so it's anchored in, and then feed it up through the pin, and then use your tuning key to really crank it up. Yes, it fortunately the today has been really dry and yesterday's been dry and the day before, but I think we're supposed to get more rain and it fluctuates when the weather fluctuates. So if it's super humid, super humid, I have to take more time in order to tune it up. Since I'm not playing with anybody else, I kind of tune it to myself. But if I'm tuning to like a flute player or something like that, yes, then I use my Korg and tune it up to A.
I know that pianists would prefer to have big hands and long fingers
Right.
play guitar, and I would also aspire to those things.
Right.
But I wonder about harp players.
When I was studying the Salzedo method, there just was no choice. some of these reaches were bigger than an octave. They asked me to play an octave plus two notes, and it was really hard to hold on to that. But back then, you don't say, no, I can't do that. You know, you just kind of say, yes, I'll do it. There was no choice. And there was no choice as far as choosing your own music back then. They just said, this is what you're going to do. And okay. So when, after college, and I thought, wow, this is great fun. I can play in restaurants and play what I want to play. And that was kind of the cool stuff. Actually, it was my mom's. It was my mom's choice, and my dad decided, of course, you know, whatever my mom wanted, my dad went along with it. And so, little did I know, she took me down to a symphony concert in Milwaukee. And at the end of the concert, the harpist was putting her cover on the harp, and you know, she whipped my, you know, hand up and dragged me up onto the stage, and she said, oh, I love your harp, and do you think you could teach my daughter, you know, down here how to play the harp? And she said, okay, sure. so it was a big surprise to me. And then there were years, I mean, there's harpists that have wanted to, that have been dying to play, that, you know, people, women who would say, oh, I wish I played the harp. Now I think this is great, but back in high school, definitely. I would go to my parents and I said, well, I just don't think this is for me anymore. And they said that quitting was not an option. So I got my first harp. It was a troubadour harp, but that didn't last too long because the teachers needed me to start on the pedal harp. And my first big harp, the first big harp was in junior high school. And I didn't take very good care of it, you know, because I didn't. I was a kid. Now I just like, oh, that does the same. Yeah, Noreen. Yeah, I do, especially if I'm playing by myself in a, you know, with nobody watching me.
Right.
Or if I'm in a room or a lobby where everything is going on and people go, how can you stand all that noise? I was like, I just tune it out and I'm just kind of in my own little world. And I'm also able to try out things that I wouldn't normally try out on people, like, you know, some Led Zeppelin or, you know, that type of thing, you know. So, yeah. Yeah. So, I'll be around for a few more minutes. Thank you so much for coming and I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.